verses 6 to 9. Paul's travels up and down to do good. He and Silas, his colleague, went throughout Phrygia and the region of Galatia, where, it should seem, the gospel was already planted, but whether by Paul's hand or no is not mentioned. It is likely it was, for in his epistle to the Galatians he speaks of his preaching the gospel to them at the first, and how very acceptable he was among them, Galatians 4:13-15. And it appears by that epistle that the Judaizing teachers had then done a great deal of mischief to these churches of Galatia, had prejudiced them against Paul and drawn them from the gospel of Christ, for which he there severely reproves them. But probably that was a great while after this. They were forbidden at this time to preach the gospel in Asia, the country properly so called, because it did not need other hands being at work there, or because the people were not yet prepared to receive it, as they were afterwards, ch. 19:10, when all those that dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord, or, as Dr. Lightfoot suggests, because at this time Christ would employ Paul in a piece of new work, which was to preach the gospel to a Roman colony at Philippi, for hitherto the Gentiles to whom he had preached were Greeks. The Romans were more particularly hated by the Jews than other Gentiles, their armies were the abomination of desolation, and therefore there is this among other things extraordinary in his call thither that he is forbidden to preach the gospel in Asia and other places, in order to his preaching it there, which is an intimation that the light of the gospel would in after times be directed more westward than eastward. It was the Holy Ghost that forbade them, either by secret whispers in the minds of both of them, which, when they came to compare notes, they found to be the same, and to come from the same Spirit, or by some prophets who spoke to them from the Spirit. The removals of ministers, and the dispensing of the means of grace by them, are in a particular manner under a divine guidance and direction. We find an Old Testament minister forbidden to preach at all, Ezekiel 3:26, thou shalt be dumb. But these New Testament ministers are only forbidden to preach in one place, while they are directed to another where there is more need. They would have gone into Bithynia, but were not permitted, the Spirit suffered them not, v. 7. They came to Mysia, and, as it should seem, preached the gospel there, for though it was a very mean contemptible country, even to a proverb, miserum ultimus, in Cicero, is a most despicable man, yet the apostles disdained not to visit it, owning themselves debtors both to the wise and to the unwise, Rom 1:14. In Bithynia was the city of Nice, where the first general council was held against the Arians. Into these countries Peter sent his epistle, 1 Pt 1:1, and there were flourishing churches here, for, though they had not the gospel sent them now, they had it in their turn, not long after. Observe, though their judgment and inclination were to go into Bithynia, yet, having then extraordinary ways of knowing the mind of God, they were overruled by them, contrary to their own mind. We must now follow Providence, and submit to the guidance of that pillar of cloud and fire, and, if this suffer us not to do what we essay to do, we ought to acquiesce, and believe it for the best. The Spirit of Jesus suffered them not, so many ancient copies read it. The servants of the Lord Jesus ought to be always under the check and conduct of the Spirit of the Lord Jesus, by whom he governs men's minds. They passed by Mysia, or passed through it, so some, sowing good seed, we may suppose, as they went along, and they came down to Troas, the city of Troy, so much talked of, or the country thereabouts, which took its denomination from it. Here a church was planted, for here we find one in being, ch. 20:6-7, and probably planted at this time, and in a little time. It should seem that at Troas Luke fell in with Paul, and joined himself to his company, for henceforward, for the most part, when he speaks of Paul's journeys, he puts himself into the number of his retinue, we went, v. 10. Paul's particular call to Macedonia, that is, to Philippi, the chief city, inhabited mostly by Romans, as appears, v. 21. Here we have the vision Paul had, v. 9. Paul had many visions, sometimes to encourage, sometimes, as here, to direct him in his work. An angel appeared to him, to intimate to him that it was the will of Christ he should go to Macedonia. Let him not be discouraged by the embargo laid upon him once and again, by which his designs were crossed, for, though he shall not go where he has a mind to go, he shall go where God has work for him to do. The person Paul saw. There stood by him a man of Macedonia, who by his habit or dialect seemed so to Paul, or who told him he was so. The angel, some think, assumed the shape of such a man, or, as others think, impressed upon Paul's fancy, when between asleep and awake, the image of such a man, he dreamt he saw such a one. Christ would have Paul directed to Macedonia, not as the apostles were at other times, by a messenger from heaven, to send him thither, but by a messenger thence to call him thither, because in this way he would afterwards ordinarily direct the motions of his ministers, by inclining the hearts of those who needed them to invite them. Paul shall be called to Macedonia by a man of Macedonia, and by him speaking in the name of the rest. Some make this man to be the tutelar angel of Macedonia, supposing angels to have charge of particular places as well as persons, and that so much is intimated Dan 10:20, where we read of the princes of Persia and Grecia, that seem to have been angels. But there is no certainty of this. There was presented either to Paul's eyes or to his mind a man of Macedonia. The angel must not preach the gospel himself to the Macedonians, but must bring Paul to them. Nor must he by the authority of an angel order him to go, but in the person of a Macedonian court him to come. A man of Macedonia, not a magistrate of the country, much less a priest, Paul was not accustomed to receive invitations from such, but an ordinary inhabitant of that country, a plain man, that carried in his countenance marks of probity and seriousness, that did not come to banter Paul nor trifle with him, but in good earnest and with all earnestness to importune his assistance. The invitation given him. This honest Macedonian prayed him, saying, "Come over into Macedonia, and help us," that is, come and preach the gospel to us, let us have the benefit of thy labors. Thou hast helped many, we have heard of those in this and the other country to whom thou hast been very useful, and why may we not put in for a share? O come and help us. The benefits others have received from the gospel should quicken our inquiries, our further inquiries, after it. It is thy business, and it is thy delight, to help poor souls. Thou art a physician for the sick, that art to be ready at the call of every patient, O come and help us. We have need of thy help, as much as any people. We in Macedonia are as ignorant and as careless in religion as any people in the world are as idolatrous and as vicious as any, and as ingenious and industrious to ruin ourselves as any, and therefore, O come, come with all speed among us. If thou canst do anything, have compassion on us, and help us. Those few among us that have any sense of divine things, and any concern for their own souls and the souls of others, have done what can be done, by the help of natural light, I have done my part for one. We have carried the matter as far as it will go, to persuade our neighbors to fear and worship God, but we can do little good among them. O come, come, thou over, and help us. The gospel thou preachest has arguments and powers beyond those we have yet been furnished with. Do not only help us with thy prayers here, this will not do, thou must come over and help us. Note, people have great need of help for their souls, and it is their duty to look out for it and invite those among them that can help them.